Are you 10?
No, relax.
It's very interesting.
Yeah. Okay.
Hi, I'm Dr. Liew. I'm from the Asian Heart and Vascular Centre.
And hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Choong from Nobel Heart Centre. And today we are here to have a short discussion.
Yeah.
And about talking about the different aspects of heart health, especially dispelling some misunderstanding about various treatment as well as various blood tests.
Yeah, and I think the things that we're going to discuss are real issues that we often come across in our daily practice as well.
So maybe let me kickstart first with a few simple questions. I have patients coming in saying their cholesterol profile, which they regularly check, was good last year and maybe not so good and a bit more borderline this year. So in your practice, what is considered a good cholesterol level and what is not good?
Yeah, I think that's a great question because gone are the days, I feel, where we use standardized levels as a benchmark for whether you define the person as having a good enough cholesterol level. I think cholesterol level management nowadays should be individualized. So probably the first thing you need to do is to establish what's the cardiovascular risk profile of the patient. And then you can then work with the patient to determine what is the level and the target of the cholesterol that you want to achieve.
Cholesterol is not like a competition, right? Like what you shared, it's not like, oh, my LDL was 2.5, yours is 2.8. You're not doing so well, my friend. I don't think it works that way because risk factors, like you said, is global and there are multifactorial reasons why certain people are at higher risk. We talk about things like exposomes, where there are environmental triggers and factors like poor sleep, like, you know, pollution of light and sound and different things that we think are minor but eventually do affect long-term cardiovascular risk. And this is just part and parcel of the overall picture. Cholesterol plays a big part, of course, but not the entire part. So like you said, I think totally we have to contextualize each patient based on their merits and risk factors. So second common question I get from my patients at least is their concerns over starting medications for cholesterol, especially statins.
I think statins is a very misunderstood drug, I feel. I think there's a lot of data, as you are aware, that of the benefits of taking statins, both for preventing that first cardiac event or stroke event, as well as also a secondary prevention in patients who already had a cardiac or stroke event. But the thing is that there's a lot of fears about statin, the medication, you know, or the muscle breakdown, the muscle aches, the liver damage that people always talk about. You know, you go to the coffee shop, everybody starts to discuss this side effects of statins, and then you end up everybody dropping off their medications, which is actually quite worrying. Obviously, when you stop taking your medications, you are going to lose the protective effect of the medication. So instead of patients saying that, oh, you know, if I go on a drug and I have to take it lifelong, is because their risk for that cardiovascular event is lifelong. It's not going to go away. For example, if you have got high cholesterol and you don't treat it, it's going to come back up again. If you have got diabetes, it's not going to disappear. If you have got a strong family history of early heart attack or stroke, it's not going to disappear. These things won't change.
So which category of patients would you say must really remain on lifelong or at least very, very long-term statins?
Well, I think first and foremost, for those who require statins for secondary prevention, meaning that they already had a history of heart artery disease, treatment, heart attack, or for example, a stroke, then these patients should be on statins lifelong, and that shouldn't change. Two, if you have got very high cholesterol due to a familial component, meaning a genetic inheritance, that risk will never come down, honestly. So I think this group of patients should also remain on cholesterol lowering therapy lifelong as well. I guess the ones that really, where you can negotiate for reduction in dose, perhaps will be for primary prevention, maybe in somebody who had a little bit of borderline high cholesterol and yet their risk profile is not really very high. So maybe those patients might be the ones. But I would say that the threshold to start statins is getting a little bit lower nowadays.
Maybe I share with you a patient, a real life patient I just saw this morning. Yeah. And this is a 55-year-old lady, basically with high cholesterol for quite a few years. I think her GP has advised to take statins, but she has been resistant for a long time. And husband, though, has gone ahead and introduced hypocol for her, which she has been taking quite religiously for the last 2 to 3 years. Last month, she developed an episode of chest discomfort after an argument in the family. So she got a bit concerned because of this chest discomfort and her age. So she came to us. And some imaging was done, and we found that she had some minor coronary artery disease in one of the main artery, the left anterior descending artery. It's not serious enough for us to go ahead with the intervention with ballooning or stenting. Sure. But this time, I did have another round of discussion about statins with her. So if this patient appeared in your clinic, what would your approach be?
Most of the time, I would say that supplements like hypocol, they are very, very weak in terms of the reduction, the ability to reduce your LDL. So chances are she's not going to be able to hit the target with just taking hypocol for lipid lowering. And I think for most people, like hypocol is like a red yeast extract, which is actually very similar to a very, very, very weak statin anyway. So I think nowadays with so many options available, combinations available, good potency medications with a very manageable side effect, I don't see the extra benefit of taking something that is low potency when you have already diagnosed a heart artery disease.
Okay, moving on. Something that's emerging, actually not emerging, has been around for a while but gaining more prominence and awareness, is this thing called lipoprotein A.
Yeah.
Now, can you share with our audience and doctor friends out there, what is lipoprotein A and why should we be concerned about this particle?
And lipoprotein A, you can think of it as a bad cholesterol particle, similar to your LDL cholesterol. Mm-hmm. Now, the unique thing about lipoprotein A is that the levels are pretty much determined by the individual's genetic makeup, which means to say that if you have got the genetic makeup that predisposes you to producing high levels of lipoprotein A, then the levels are not going to change very much. Even with exercise, dietary changes, etc., the change will not be major. So we have also have enough studies to tell us that patients with high lipoprotein A are actually at higher cardiovascular risk as well.
Now, the question always is, a lot of these cutting-edge medications are coming online, but not so soon on the horizon. They are, like you said, phase 2, phase 3, things like olpasiran, pelacarsen, and many other things that are very exciting, but they're not here yet. So in light of that, what can we do?
I think the current consensus is to use lipoprotein A to drive initiatives to really strengthen and optimize your risk factor management of all your other existing risk factors. That means if you have got hypertension or you have got diabetes, you really need to be more aggressive in terms of your control. Personally, I would aim for much lower LDL targets so that we can really try and maximize the cardiovascular risk reduction.
And in these cases, I drive their LDL to very, very low levels just to compensate for the risk that lipoprotein A brings about. And we know that lipoprotein A is highly, highly atherogenic, meaning they are more potent than LDL in creating plaques or cholesterol deposits in all the major arteries, especially the heart and brain. So very important to mitigate what you can and what you cannot. Things are coming online, so we just have to wait for just a few years.
Yeah,
so we seek everyone's patience.
It should be very exciting to watch the lipoprotein A space.
Yeah, great. So in conclusion, I think it's a very useful discussion we had. These are truly the day-to-day questions we receive from patients, either walk-in or from comments on different fora. And ultimately, I think shared decision-making and communicating awareness and understanding of the various treatments, the various targets of treatment is very important, be it in terms of cholesterol control, be it in terms of some misunderstanding about statins.
Fully agree. I think helping the patients to understand their conditions and their risk profile really will empower them and help them to be able to make the right decisions to adhere to whatever recommended treatments that they should be on.
Yeah. So thank you for your time.
Thank you.
We hope you learned something useful from this.
Yeah. See you next time. Servier. Moved by you.